Good afternoon, Santa Clarita. We're joining us here on 98.1 FM, AM 1220 KHTS for the Providence Holy Cross Health Hour. I'm Tom Burton, and gosh darn it, what a beautiful day out there in Santa Clarita. And for those watching on Facebook Live, how you doing? I literally, the minute the camera goes on, the nose starts to itch, got to start hand sanitizing, and glasses fog up because of the mask. And, you know, we have to continue practicing, practicing our safer at home and social distancing and, you know, keeping our own germs to ourselves by wearing the masks when we're breathing. So, that's a must. And we need to continue doing that. Here we are, beautiful day. We are doing well as a city. We're doing well as a county. We are doing well as a state. And all of that comes from the efforts that everybody is doing. And someone had the greatest analogy the other day, is this isn't the time to start getting out, taking the masks off, and going back into gatherings. This is a time where we need to put the full court press on and continue the hard work, the difficult work that everybody's been doing, so we can continue to have these successes. And the analogy is, if you come out of halftime in a football game, which we can't wait for football to start, draft is coming, I think, in the next day or today.
Starts tomorrow, Tom.
Starts tomorrow. Yeah. Very good. All right. So, in a football game, you come back at halftime and you are winning. The last thing you're going to do is say, okay, for the second half, guys, I think we've got this one in the bag. We're just going to take our helmet and we're going to take our pads off. You're not going to do that, all right? So we need to continue to be smart, and we're going to be going over a bunch of things that will hopefully help as far as reminding us of all the important things that we need to be doing, need to continue doing, following the advice of our CDC and our Department of Public Health. They are looking at all of this. They have a team of extremely smart people, epidemiologists, who are looking at modeling to see how and what this virus is going to be progressing. What are we to expect? Because of the efforts that everybody is making, we're not hitting the numbers that was originally anticipated, all right? And that's because of effort, all right? It takes a lot of effort. It takes a lot of effort not to go outside. On a day like today, it takes a lot of effort to work from home. It takes a lot of effort to walk around with a face mask on and not be able to see out of your glasses. It takes a lot of effort to remember that every time you touch your face, go wash your hands. Every time you do something, go wash your hands. Every time you have to go out into the public, put the mask on, hand sanitize, make sure you wipe everything down that you're going to be using. There's so much we have to remember, but keep doing it. We're doing great, all right? And I think the longer we are capable of keeping up this hard press that we've been doing over the last bunch of weeks, the sooner we're going to be able to emerge from the caves that we've been stuck in. And that will be well-paced as well. And those smart individuals, MDs, PhDs, epidemiologists, they are going to help guide us and navigate us on how we can actually get back out into the public forum, in what order, to ensure that we don't have a spike. And unfortunately, there are other states that are electing that, you know, they're not going to follow the advice. And, you know, my hope is that spike isn't going to happen. There's a lot of concern there. So we want to make sure we continue to follow. So Providence Holy Cross is here for you. All right. And we remain open. We are recently, as of yesterday, in fact, we want to throw a big thank you out as well. Yesterday, the Bomb Parade Car Club, as well as LA Councilwoman Monica Rodriguez, they brought food for the entire staff to Holy Cross, which, you know, we can't thank our community for gestures so kind as that. But our staff are amazing. They are truly heroes. You know, normally people walk away from an issue, they walk towards the issue. And they do it regularly, they do it proudly, and they do it effectively, and they do it caringly. So, a beautiful gesture by the club, as well as LA Councilwoman Monica Rodriguez, and we truly do appreciate that. And they worked in conjunction with the community restaurants to provide that food. And a special thanks goes out to them as well. A special thanks goes out to the staff who are walking in the doors of Holy Cross every day to be able to help not only take care of any COVID cases that may occur, but just to be able to take care of all of our patients. And that's a really, really important thing, because Santa Clarita, you make up about 33% of our patients. And Santa Clarita, Holy Cross employees, probably about 40% of them live out here in Santa Clarita. So we are amongst you, we are a part of you, we support you, and continue to look forward to in doing so. So that being said, you know, we wanna make sure that you do what you need to do so that we don't need to see you in the meantime, all right? And hopefully being able to stay healthy. So, you know, I have a reflection that was sent out to our staff. And for those of you who are listening on the radio or on the podcast or on the app, you make sure that you get the app, especially if you're gonna be leaving the Santa Clarita Valley, so that driving around, so that way you can continue listening. But Patty Mayberry said, we care for every patient that walks in our door. No matter how vulnerable, we don't turn them away. It's our culture, and it's ingrained in each one of us. All right, that's an important piece. That is actually part of the mission. We will take care of everybody, and we will not turn our back. We will continue to treat and continue to be to help our communities and those that are in need. So, you know, we thank the administration. We thank the Providence St. Joseph Health system-wide, allowing us the opportunity to be able to continue to be successful with anybody who walks through the doors. And it's still busy. Shockingly enough, I had a chance to chat with our ER chief of the emergency room today, and they are still being utilized, and which is great, because we want to be there for. And it's not COVID patients; it's patients who are in medical need, and that's something we do need to remember. Right now, though, there are issues with COVID-19 virus, and people are concerned. We still have issues, you know, with GI problems and heart problems and strokes and orthopedic issues and trauma that still need to be addressed in the urgent and emergent way that we normally would. So again, a big thank you out to all of our care providers over at Holy Cross for continuing to answer that call. We need to make sure, all right, don't let up. Stay home. No gatherings. If you must be out, wear your face mask. Yes, it's uncomfortable. Yes, don't breathe really well in these. Yes, I can't see my own computer screen because I'm continuously fogged up. But we need to be able to do it. Wash your hands, all right? For those of you, if the camera was on, already antiseptic wiped everything around the workstation here for the show today. Already hand sanitized once. I will most likely hand sanitize one or two more times before the show is over with. And so we need to keep this up. Dr. Fossey and Dr. Burks have said that the treatments and vaccines will eventually come, all right? But we can't wait for those. Our success is going to be in the change of behavior, all right? And that's our behavior, all right? And that's going to be making sure we take good care of ourselves, making sure we shelter at home, follow the advice. As difficult as it is, we need to keep that up. Treatments itself, we're going to talk about one, which I'm really excited about, because we're going to have a previous guest join us on air in the second segment today, Dr. Sammy Eghbalieh. So excited. He's a vascular surgeon at Holy Cross, just a top surgeon recognized by the city of L.A. You know, I'm really glad, because he's going to be able to talk and help us through talking about the ECMO procedure, which is being utilized in some of the more severe cases. So really excited about that. What we kind of know now, we do know that our safer at home is still extended through the 15th. The rumblings are that the school year is basically done for this year, officially, and for this semester. And they are presently working on how it's going to look for summer in summer school, and also how we're going to be returning to the fall and what that might look like. Whether it be just business as usual, maybe they have to do a hybrid type of system where they limit the number of students that actually are on campus, so you do some at home and some actually in the classroom. Hard to say what that's going to look like, but the all of our school districts are working together to make sure that they can come up with a very good plan that is based off of the CDC and public health recommendations. So more to come on that. We do know that we have to be out, if we're out in public, wear a mask, all right? Whether it be one that you make, all right, have seen some really fashionable ones out there, or it could be just one similar to what I'm wearing, or however, it could be just a bandana over your nose or your mouth. But you do need to be in a wearing a mask if you're going to be out and about. My recommendation is keep the mask with you in your car, all right? Make sure that you keep it clean. Recently, we were talking to, overheard somebody, and they said, you know, keeping your mask, if you just were out for a very short amount of time, just keeping it out in the sunshine sometimes is helpful. The UV rays deactivates viruses in general, so that might not be a bad idea. If you've worn it a couple of times, make sure that you wash it if it's washable. If not, then dispose of it and move on to another mask, so that way you are being safe and demonstrating good self-hygiene. So good mask health is going to be important, but keep it with you, because if you're going out and supporting our local restaurants and picking up, if curbside pickup, or if you have to actually go to the door, you're going to be expected to be wearing your mask. And there are going to be signs all over that you will not be permitted to go in unless you were actually wearing a mask, which means you may not be served. So please make sure you have that mask, have that bandana, have something that's going to protect you over the nose and over the mouth, so that way you're blocking. I'm still recently going shopping. I did see a number of people who had their masks pulled down below their nose while they were shopping. And the unfortunate thing is you're still exhaling through the nose. So whatever is in your pulmonary system, you're blowing that out and you're spreading it over everything as you're walking by. Okay, so we want to make sure that we're all being very, very safe whenever we can. Of course, the concern that we always have right now is that 25 to 50% of the population could be walking around as carriers and shedding the virus and having no symptoms, okay? And that's one of the reasons why we have to wear the mask, because the mask isn't protecting you, isn't protecting me from you. It's protecting you from me, okay, if that makes sense. So I'm not expelling any potential virus on you. It's being blocked by the mask. That's the reason for wearing the mask, not as much to protect you while you're out, but to protect others while you're out. So make sure that you keep those masks on, okay? They're reemerging into a normal life. It's going to be evident. It's going to happen. We don't know what that's going to look like yet, but we have very, very smart people who are working on that, who are going to help navigate, which is great. And just kind of remember that we're probably still about a year away from a possible vaccine. Though, as we learned from Dr. Bernie Fox last week, that they are fast-tracking a lot of things, and we may be able to see it a skosh sooner, at least to see that they have vaccines that will work, but they still then have to create the vaccine, and that takes time. So we need to have patience as we're working through. And as time is going on, we're gaining a little bit better understanding on some of the different medications that have shown some success, maybe some that have not shown some success. One of the hard parts is having those controlled studies that will be helpful to make sure that maybe the person who did take the hydroxychloroquine, maybe they took it, but maybe they would have just gotten better anyways. And so we don't know if it's the medication that got them through, or would they have just gotten through? Okay, so that's how this research portion of it will work as well, to determine effectiveness. So they've got a lot of smart people working on trying to create the studies that will allow for determining which medications are gonna work and which medications may not, may only be placebo effect. So we're working on it. What we do know, all right, and this goes back to what Dr. Fossey and Dr. Burks were talking about, was the fact that our change in behavior, and that behavior first and foremost starts with our self-hygiene. Not any surprise, we should be doing this anyways. You use a restroom, you wash your hands, okay? You work in the garden, you come in, you wash your hands before you start touching things. If I'm working with a patient, I'm going to wash my hands when I'm done before I start touching other things. These are commonsensical type of pieces that we need to continue to do on a regular basis. So wash your hands. It has to be with soap and water, okay, not just water. The soap is, the chemical properties of soap attract to fat and protein, and help break those apart. That's the process of how soap works. And that's what viruses are made of. And so soap, after 20 seconds of sudsing up, actually destroys the virus. Okay, so we need to do that. Now, we know that soap and water may not always be available. So hand sanitizers at 60% alcohol will be very, very effective. But still, soap and water should be your first go-to if you can. Stay at home. If you don't need to be out, don't be out, okay? It takes a lot of self-discipline to not try to take advantage of weather like today and tomorrow specifically. It's supposed to be another beautiful one. So stay at home. Disinfect commonly touched objects and items throughout the home. Stay clean, okay? You know, you're not going to be perfect on your hand washing, and you are still breathing and things like that. So we do need to continue cleaning on a regular basis to ensure our environment is safe. And if you have to cough and sneeze into your elbow. Okay, for those on Facebook Live, you can easily just get your elbow and crease of your elbow and use that as your block. And then go and wash your hands, okay? Very, very important. Always washing your hands. If you can't use your elbow, use your hands, but make sure that you're washing. You know, I still see a lot of people walking around with gloves on, okay? It has been shown that, one, not a great practice, because everything you touch, you're just transferring, okay? And theoretically speaking, when you go to take your gloves off, by the time you're done with your trip to the grocery store, chances are you're going to infect your hands by touching your gloves, and you've now defeated the purpose. So they are not recommending that you use gloves when you go out into public, all right? Part one. Part two, if you are going to be a person who is going to be wearing gloves, dispose your gloves into a trash can, all right? There are too many signs of people just dropping their gloves and leaving them in the parking lots and leaving them on the ground, leaving them on the sidewalks, okay? It's not good. That's littering. It's not healthy. Please be respectful, not only to yourself, but not only to your neighbors and to those who have to walk through that area, but today is also Earth Day. All right, probably not a bad idea that we should be taking care of the earth as well. And if anything demonstrates that even more so, us not driving around as much and staying home more often and not, you know, gathering to a point where we're dumping pollution all over the place, the earth looks better. And they've been able to demonstrate that. So we need to stay diligent with this. No public or private gatherings. Please, 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 everybody listen to this, all right? You're not supposed to get together, all right? It's whoever you come in contact with, you're coming in contact not only with them, but everyone they've come in contact with. And then you're going to take that back to your house, maybe to your grandparents, maybe to a sick relative or however. And those people are potentially going to get sick, all right? Please don't gather, all right? We've been instructed not to do this, but I do know, even specifically here in Santa Clarita, that continues to occur. So please, 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 let's follow this advice. we need to just, in general, stay healthy ourselves, hydrate, eat well, try to get plenty of sleep, make sure that we exercise. We are allowed to be out to exercise, okay? It's purposeful. Our reason to be out needs to be purposeful. If it is to exercise, perfect. Go ahead and exercise. Make sure that you maintain social distancing if you're going out as a group. But if it's to exercise, and again, no gatherings more than five people. So if you have a group larger than five, you guys need to break it up, okay? So make sure that you are exercising, trying to stay as healthy as you possibly can. But if you are having any issues mentally, you know, this is a big problem. This is a huge change to our routine. And we heard from Dr. Doug Polster a couple weeks ago on how changing a routine or being thrown out of your routine can really affect us mentally. It can cause depression, lack of focus, and the such. And so we really do need to kind of take a moment and do our own mental inventory. Make sure that you're doing well. See how you feel. There are a number of different places where you can look up online to see, you know, how you are doing. If you're depressed, and people who you can talk to, okay? So make sure that you're staying well, not only physically, but also mentally as well, okay? Very, very important. And if you are feeling sick, hey, listen, you're gonna need to stay home, all right? Quarantine yourself. And probably one of the biggest pieces of advice we have is take a note of what you're feeling. You know, do you have a fever? Is it over 100? Make a note of it. Are you coughing? Do you have a sore throat? Are you having any issues with breathing? Is it difficult? Do you feel short of breath? All of these are common signs. These are signs that you will also see with a cold, but also could be because of COVID-19. Now, the probably biggest piece of advice is don't run off to your doctor's office. Don't run off to the urgent care. Definitely do not run off to the emergency room. Chances are they're going to turn you right around and send you home. All right. The main piece of it is call your doctor first. Contact your healthcare provider or do a virtual health visit. And between the two of those, they're going to help take you through a line of questioning to make a determination of what your next steps are going to be. Maybe you just need to shelter at home, quarantine away from the family, and treat the symptoms under their advice, all right? That's one of the other pieces, too, is that I know that there's a lot of confusion of what can you take versus what can't you take. And this is why we have physicians here. Let's let them help in navigating those decisions, whether it be over-the-counter or prescriptive, all right, it's going to be very, very important. And if they feel that your symptoms are bad enough at that point in time, they may say, yeah, listen, we need you to come in. Or they may say, we're going to have you go to the emergency room, okay? That would be the time. Now, if you are having something urgent, emergent, chest pains, things like that, and to a point where you feel you're not doing well and it's getting worse and worse and worse and you feel threatened because of this, you may need to just go directly to the emergency room. It's not to say you shouldn't go to the emergency room, but let's let our healthcare providers and our virtual health providers assist if it isn't so emergent. Okay, so make sure that you are doing that as well. And remember, if you're quarantining, it's 14 days, okay? We need to make sure that we keep ourselves away. And we need to keep ourselves away from everybody. You heard from our CEO over at Holy Cross, Bernie Klein, a couple weeks ago that his son, who was studying abroad, came back from Spain. And they basically just stuffed him into a room and left him there. And he was able to use one room and one bathroom, and that was it. And they virtually brought him in for dinners at night, setting a computer at his usual spot at the table. You know, this is serious stuff. And this, if this is a physician who's really taking this approach, we really do need to take note and follow a lot of the advice that we are hearing, okay? But really important is just make sure that you talk with your healthcare provider prior to taking medications, prior to self-treating, to ensure that you're making the best decisions and making the best choices and how you're going to be caring for yourself while you're at home. Now, Holy Cross, hey, listen, it's been something. We have a lot of people who working behind the scenes to ensure that processes are in place. I did have to go to visit the hospital for some things for myself. And, you know, you get your temperature taken, you answer some questions. You can only go in through the emergency room. Employees now are only going to be allowed to go in through the Indian Hills entrance and over by the MRI. You know, we're trying to ensure that all staff have had temperature taken, all staff have to attest to their health. We have specific areas where patients who are even suspected of having COVID-19 are being cared for that are kind of away from the other patients to ensure that we're not cross-infecting. This is important, and Holy Cross is really good at this, and it's proven to the fact that our sepsis is the lowest in all of Southern California of the Providence facilities. Our hospital-acquired infections are almost nil, and you know, when you start throwing up numbers like that, you're looking at being a top 50 hospital in the nation, which, by the way, Holy Cross is. So they are putting processes together. We've learned so much from our Washington hospitals, who started working within the COVID piece a week or two ahead of us, and including the fact that some of their staff and traveling nurses are coming down to assist, which we can't be more thankful for, to try to learn from their learnings as they were going through it. If you're a visitor, chances are you're not getting in. All right, there's only a few people who are allowed in besides patients, and that's going to be someone with maternity, somebody who is accompanying a minor who is going into the hospital, or if it's a end-of-life care that is imminent, that the house supervisor will make that decision. Otherwise, just don't come to the hospital, okay? They're going to be turned away. This is important. Again, we don't want to bring the outside into the hospital to infect our patients, to infect our staff. We want to ensure their safety, but also we don't want to have people coming in at that time because we want to protect them as well. So You know, this is so, so important. And, you know, as we're looking at this, Providence has been really, really on the forefront of what's been going on. We know as far as our cleaning of N95 masks, we learned from Dr. From Bernie last week, our number of trials that we're involved with for a variety of different medications. Down in Orange County, we have a facility that's working with convalescent plasma and how they're going to be treating those moderate to severe cases to determine if that helps. That convalescent plasma, meaning that those persons have already had COVID-19 and have the antibodies present, and hopefully that will help for those moderate to severe cases. And, you know, I got the high sign that says, the process that we saw at St. John's, we have probably a huge expert that will be joining us for our second segment, Dr. Sammy Eghbalieh, and I'm so glad that he's going to be able to join us because I think he's going to be able to shed some light on how it works, why it works, the importance of it. And I just can't wait to be able to bring that out, because this was something that was very well featured on TV, and it's an exciting concept on how we're going to be able to care for those severe cases going forward. So we're going to be right back. You're joining us on the Providence Holy Cross Health Hour and KHTS 98.1 FM, AM 1220. We'll be right back.
Olive Terrace Bar and Grill is the hottest new Mediterranean fusion restaurant in Santa Clarita, with unique delicacies like seafood right off the boat, mouth-watering prime steaks, artesian sandwiches, delicious pastas, and tasty kebabs. Unwind on their cozy outdoor patio at their weekend champagne brunch, full menu, and weekly specials at oliveterracebarandgrill.com. Check out their full bar and happy hour daily specials in Valencia on Copper Hill and Newhall Ranch Road by LA Fitness. Olive Terrace Bar and Grill, delicious food seasoned with love.
We all know sometimes people lose their way. If you or someone you know is struggling with addiction, The Way Out Recovery SCV may have the answers you've been waiting for. The Way Out is the premier intensive outpatient treatment center serving Santa Clarita. Asking for help is the first step. Call The Way Out today, 661-296-4444. That's 296-4444 for a private free assessment. The Way Out is an accredited, affordable outpatient program that accepts most insurance. Call us at 661-296-4444 or check us out online at thewayoutrecoverysCV.com. Quit battling with yourself. Ask The Way Out for help today.
This is Suzette Martinez-Valadares. Many child care centers are closed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. The child care providers that are open are serving our essential workforce and finding it very difficult to find or purchase the supplies needed to keep their facilities clean and children healthy. Our healthcare professionals are fighting to save lives. First responders and law enforcement are bravely serving our community. And our grocery store clerks are keeping our local markets stocked. This is our chance to help them. This is why we are launching Operation Child Care. Our mission is to collect donations for local early childhood education providers serving our frontline essential workforce. Donations needed include hand sanitizer, disinfectant wipes, disinfectant spray, disposable gloves, and masks. These donations can be dropped off at KHTS Radio, located at 24320 Main Street in Newhall, from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. Monday through Friday.
He broke records and piloted the F-18 Super Hornet in combat. Answering our nation's call, he served with honor. Then Mike Garcia returned home to his family, to a far worse California from where he grew up. Now, Garcia's next mission: cut taxes, clean up homelessness in our cities. With California on the brink, we need a fighter to answer the call once again. Mike Garcia for Congress.
I'm Mike Garcia, and I approve this message.
Town Cleaners on Soledad is offering free dry cleaning for all first responders and medical personnel. Free pickup and delivery is also available. Call Mo at 250-1542. 250-1542. Town Cleaners on Soledad.
City Councilman Bob Keller here. Keep it tuned to 98.1 FM and AM 1220 KHTS, hometownstation.com, for the latest information regarding COVID-19. KHTS will have both national and local news and information during this unprecedented time. For more, go to the KHTS website or the KHTS Facebook page. KHTS is also available online in the free app for iPhone and Android. Continue to social distance, only going out if it's absolutely necessary, and continue to check on friends and family. With your help, we will flatten the curve and come through this stronger than ever. Thank you.
Welcome back, Santa Clarita. You join us there for the second segment here on the Providence Holy Cross Health Hour, coming to you from KHTS, live from the Newhall Studios. So much, such a beautiful day. Glad to be able to escape the house, be able to come out and do this, and then go shelter myself back in where I know I'll be safer at home. You're joining us on 98.1 FM, AM 1220. You're joining us on the app. You can get that. If you don't have it, get it for your Android, for your Apple phone. Make sure you have it, especially because you get nice, clear signal anytime you're out and about, including internationally. So very, very important. You're joining us on Facebook Live. I'm not sure, or up or down. Glad to have you, and thank you for joining us. And, you know, a special thanks coming up here because, you know, as we were talking about it with the different types of technology and advancements that we've been able to use and look at for treating those moderate to severe cases of COVID-19. One thing came about a week or so ago that our sister hospital, St. John's, down in Santa Monica, was using a procedure known as ECMO, and we'll talk about this with our guest. I thought, gosh darn it, this seems so interesting that maybe we need to talk about this a little bit further. And it was an easy discussion amongst myself. Usually, I'm my best company. Who do I ask? Well, if you remember, a few years ago, we had a wonderful family of brothers join us on air who are at Holy Cross and just unbelievable supporters, unbelievable physicians in their own right. One of the brothers happens to be, imagine the parents, right? I mean, a patobiliary specialist, a general surgeon, vascular surgeon, and interventional radiologist. Imagine the tuition bills, holy cow. Dr. Sammy Eghbalieh, vascular surgeon extraordinaire. And before you jump in here, Dr. Eghbalieh, let's go over the accolades because he was just voted as one of LA's top vascular surgeons. He represents Southern California for Providence in the vascular focus group. And for those of you who don't know Providence St. Joseph's Health, we have focus groups that amongst the system, seven states, we have 51 hospitals. So we have a select group of experts who represent different regions as we continue to move forward and advance our practices, our processes, and looking into the future and how we're going to continue to be the top provider of care. And also the president of the Southern California Vascular Group. And this makes me smile inside because for those of you who listen to the show enough, realize I might be a UCLA supporter, and this gentleman coming on did his medical education at UCLA, just happened to do his general surgical training at this small little university called Yale. You may have heard of that perhaps. And then his fellowship training for vascular and vascular minimally invasive vascular surgery at just another small little organization of Albany Medical Center. So, you know, we have a top trained, highly accoladed vascular surgeon who actually was able to find time out of his day to join us. Dr. Eghbalieh, thanks for joining us.
Tom, thank you so much for having me on. I definitely am humbled with aforementioned. I also would like to express my heartfelt thoughts and prayers to the patients' families that have been affected by the COVID-19. And further, would like to thank all of our first responders and fellow colleagues at all the hospitals in U.S. and international community that have been really struggling and trying to help and trying to get through this scary process for a lot of the people out there. So thank you for having me on, and I will be happy to answer any of your questions.
Oh, fantastic. You know, beautiful thoughts, and you are 100% right. And we had Bernie Klein on a couple weeks ago, and he had indicated that that it really, like anything else, it's going to take a village to get us through this, and that village happens to be global, and I think you put it best. It's both nationally and internationally, we are going to solve this as a team, and we need to continue acting as one.
Absolutely.
So, you know, we had something interesting over at St. John's. One of the patients who was diagnosed COVID-19 and really went into a severe case of ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome, and they put him on a technology that was kind of new to me. They put him on a ECMO procedure. Extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. Can you give some information? One, what is this procedure? Because it sounds an awful lot like just bypass.
Sure. This technology has been around a little bit over 10 years. And initially, when ECMO, as you mentioned, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, is essentially, think of it as a outside lung. It functions as a lung. It's what you can think of as a bypass, where during the crisis of respiratory failure, where patients that their lung function is not working, is unable to oxygenate the blood, we have created a system that enables us to, with these large catheters that we place in the big arteries and big veins, we take blood out of the body, we oxygenate it, and we give it back, essentially doing the function that the lung would otherwise be doing if it was not in this severe illness. And we really saw the benefits of ECMO coming into play in 2009 when we had the swine flu pandemic. And at that time, you know, the patients that had developed respiratory failure, where the lung functions were poor, we started to see some benefits. And of course, as you mentioned, our sister hospital has been the first in this area that has really been incorporating it now with the COVID patients. And, you know, you have to obviously outweigh the risk and benefits, but I can elaborate more about it. But essentially, it's a technology that we're all learning as we speak. We're trying it. There are centers that are trying this and trying to see if this can be another way to facilitate the recovery of our patients that are otherwise struggling being on the ventilator.
Yeah, it's so well put. And, you know, as an orthopedic sports medicine guy myself, the concept of rest, you know, on an injury to allow the body to do what is necessary, or we might immobilize her, however, it sounds very similar, that we're just going to give the lungs a few days off so that way they can heal appropriately. Is that a fair analogy?
That is a very fair analogy. Essentially, you're bypassing the lungs, taking the stress away from the what we call the pulmonary system, and essentially letting this machine do the work. And obviously, with, you know, this is a very invasive procedure. We always have to evaluate the risks and benefits. And, you know, in cases such as this, you know, where there are patients that the recovery would be detrimental, this may be an avenue that we can explore and try to see if we can help patients get through this process.
Well, I think that's a great springboard into maybe talking about that who would not be appropriate for this? Because you hear about a new technology and everybody wants it, but not everybody should be getting this.
Correct. The patients that tend to, well, to give you a little bit of an overview, in general, non-COVID patients that do go on ECMO, survival from that process is about 50%. So you can imagine that with a non-COVID patient, survival is essentially 50-50. With the COVID, now you're unsure of what the survival will be because there's just not enough data out there. The process of patients that do fall into this category, these are patients that would otherwise be what they consider high-risk patients, patients that have cardiac disease, patients that have a baseline pulmonary disease, that with the COVID infection cannot compensate with their own body, even with the ventilator, to really oxygenate their blood. And these are patients that will tend to fall into being a candidate for the ECMO. Now, with that, the procedure itself does carry complications and risks such as bleeding, stroke, and infection. So it really, it's a very careful decision-making by the team of selecting patients that would benefit, because it does require a significant amount of resources from the hospital, especially going on this machine.
Right. So there is, like anything else, you know, weighing the risks over benefits to determine if this is a correct direction to be able to go. And I really appreciate the fact that you've brought that up, that that it is going to be appropriate for some and maybe not for others. And I think that's a main piece. And it's just nice to know that, you know, our physicians and our care teams have that in their quiver, so to speak, as a tool that may be effective for that cohort that actually fits who would benefit the most from that.
Correct. And, you know, I'm very proud of our sister hospital that they've initiated this avenue of option. It's always great seeing different institutions, especially with Providence Health System, really being at the forefront of giving the patients the best that's out there. And I think the FDA has also been very helpful with allowing and issuing guidance to help expand the availability of the devices that could be used for ECMO, which has also been very helpful. So as you can see, that this whole process has really brought in a collaboration of everyone's knowledge, everyone's help, to really try to get us through this. And I think that's one of the takeaway points, is that we will get through this. We will get past this. This will take effort by all, and being optimistic and looking at all the available science that's there, we will find the answer, and we'll hopefully be able to save millions of patients' lives.
I 100% concur. I know we're going to go break for a quick commercial. Would you have a few more minutes to be able to stick on when we come back?
It would be a pleasure. No problem.
Wonderful. Okay, you're joining us here on the Providence Holy Cross Health Hour with Tom Burton and Dr. Sammy Eghbalieh on 98.1 FM, AM 1220, KHTS. We'll see you soon.
The stress was unbelievable. Debbie Morris is a changed woman. A giant boulder's been lifted.
Debbie called Made for You.
I'd finished a day of work.
Professional, residential, and commercial cleaning.
Walk into my house.
Made for You.
It was an absolute pigsty.
Weekly, bi-weekly, monthly, or even one-time seasonal cleaning.
Our mess kept growing.
255-2922.
Even when we weren't home.
255-2922.
Made for You rescued me.
This is Bradley Gross from Santa Clarita Grocery. Santa Clarita Grocery serves fresh groceries to families, individuals, and those experiencing homelessness. At Santa Clarita Grocery, out of every dollar donated, a full 99 cents goes directly to the needs being addressed. As an all-volunteer-led organization, we operate on a 1% overhead, receiving no government funding for our operations in the community, resulting in us being one of the most efficient charities in the Santa Clarita Valley. If you're looking to support the good for our community, please consider partnering with us by donating to Santa Clarita Grocery. What is donated is specifically kept in the Santa Clarita Valley, helping over 3,000 families, including five other community charities. Please visit our website, santaclaritagrocery.org, or visit us on social media or call us at 425-7575. That's 425-7575.
As the stay-at-home order continues through the month of April, Burger King is committed to following state and federal safety guidelines when it comes to serving you, the customer. Although in-restaurant dining has closed, pickup and delivery service continues. The current hours are 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. You can mobile order through the BK app for pickup, or you can use any of the delivery services like DoorDash, Uber Eats, Grubhub, and Postmates. Burger King on Lyons at the 5 Freeway, now with service at 2 drive-thru windows.
Welcome to the Providence Holy Cross Hour. The following is paid programming and does not necessarily reflect the opinions of KHTS or its ownership.
Give me the news, I've got a bad case of loving you. No pills gonna cure my ear. I got a bad case of loving you.
And welcome back, Santa Clarita. Joining us here on the Providence Holy Cross Health Hour on 98.1 FM, AM 1220 KHTS. And you're joining us for the last few minutes of our show, and we have a wonderful individual personally, and an amazing vascular surgeon who was able to find time out of the day, Dr. Sammy Eghbalieh. Thank you again for taking a moment.
Thank you again, Tom. I'd like to again thank KHTS for really getting the word out there, really reaching out to the community, and really providing the comfort that people need to have during these difficult times of the unknown. And I'm happy to be on board, and this is no trouble.
Oh, fantastic. And you know, we always talk about, you know, all the different things that we need to do and staying at home and things, and you don't have that luxury. Life continues as you continue with your practice. How has your practice changed?
Well, you know, it's interesting. Being a vascular surgeon, one of the things that we have identified with the COVID-19 is that it is still unclear, but it appears that during this severe infection, it does affect the vascular system. And what has happened is that our consultations and our evaluation and referrals have increased during this period of time, because it appears that patients are developing what we are beginning to see is called vasculitis or microthrombosis. And what has happened is that these patients' kidneys fail, their perfusion to their extremities have been affected, so we have come on board. Now, that is our hospital practice. In terms of our private practice, in regards to being able to see patients, as you know, patients have limitations of being able to go out there. People are worried to go and see their physicians. So we have really expanded our medicine into the next level, which is really doing telemedicine. Mm-hmm. And we've been able to really use our virtual technology to be able to perform consultations, be able to have patients call in, ask questions. Also, our patients from before for follow-ups, we've been able to continue at least providing the care that's there with the limitations, obviously, of travel and patients being worried about coming and seeing their physicians.
It's such an interesting time. We had Dr. Michael Nelson on with Facey a few weeks back, and he said, you know, he wasn't entirely too sure about this telemedicine thing, and guess who just got thrusted immediately into it? And he said it's about 90% of his practice, and he said it's working. Would you feel the same way?
Absolutely, especially with patients that have been established with you, where you need the usual surveillance every 3 months and so forth, follow-ups, for example. It allows you at least be able to screen patients over the phone, especially being on a face-to-face virtual evaluation, and being able to expedite almost medicine to a different level, meaning that the patient necessarily does not need to come into the office for every eval. However, it will also allow you to become more expeditious with providing the care that you need for the patients. And our practice has also expanded in that regards, and we made every effort to make sure that we are using the technology to be able to be accessible for our patients in our community, especially in Santa Clarita, Valencia, and San Fernando Valley.
That is, it's so refreshing, and I know we've got just a moment left, and we need to make sure that our patients know how to get to you. So how do they reach you?
The best way, as we perform most of the advanced vascular work for San Fernando Valley and Santa Clarita, they can call us at any time. Our number is 818-900-6480, 818-900-6480. They're more than welcome to ask for a consultation for vascular, and we'll be happy to guide them and help them through this process. And I wish everyone a safe and healthy recovery from all of this. And again, I'd like to thank all of our first responders and my co-colleagues that have been at the forefront at the hospital.
I truly appreciate it, Dr. Eghbalieh, for joining us. And I know we're going right off to commercial. You've joined us on Providence Holy Cross Health Hour. Thank you for taking the time to be with us on 98.1 FM, AM 1220, KHTS.